Thank you, Commissioner. As you can see, our title for today's Centennial Moment is Teaching the Future. Now, how do you do that? Well, you do it by learning the lessons of the past. And I'd like to start out with two quotes today about our topic. The first one, one of you, well, you're probably familiar with. It's, "Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it." And this is by Spanish philosopher and essayist George Santayana. However, I prefer the following quote, especially with how it relates to our centennial and the history book we've produced because of it. "The challenge of history is to recover the past and introduce it to the present." And this is by David Thelen, a professor of history at Indiana University, Bloomington. Knowing our past on a personal level gives us an idea as to our origins and the trials and tribulations our ancestors endured. On a superficial level, reading about the battles our ancestors fought in or the political upheavals they experienced connects us to those events. I myself have two ancestors, at least, that have fought in the American Civil War, both on the Union side, for the record. But on a deeper level, knowing about these events and such teaches us about the strength of character of our ancestors and of ourselves. They faced this. They endured this. Maybe I can endure what I'm going through as well. It's that connection, that tether to the past that we can draw pride from, draw strength from, draw wisdom from to face and navigate what might come our way in the future. On a basic level, we can say, hey, they did it. Why can't we? For the port, this is also true. The port of Vancouver's faced many challenges and tribulations in our first century. Two world wars, sordid military conflicts in Korea, Vietnam, the Middle East, depressions, recessions, strikes, fits by Mother Nature in the form of ice storms, floods, erupting volcanoes, and more. But we have endured because of the actions of our port forebears who steered our port through these often calamitous waters. Next slide, Katie. Their actions have given us insight into the possible scenarios we can take in response to the challenges we come to face as a port. As Larry pointed out in his Port Report speech, during the Great Depression of the 1930s, port managers Fred Brown and his successor, Tom McComber, along with their commissioners at the time, didn't stand idly by as the nation's economic engine was grinding down. Brown secured the construction of the grain elevator complex, which paved the way for Great Western Malting, still here, by the way, and McComber sought, fought, and secured the funds to build the port's Terminal 2 complex. These actions paved the way for further economic development during that trying time. Similarly, our actions on building Terminal 5 and the West Vancouver Freight Access Project during our Great Recession has already borne fruit, with BHP Billiton selecting the port as its preferred site for a new potash export facility. Medical information is another benefit we reap from our personal family history. What our predispositions are to certain ailments, knowing who had diabetes, cancer, dementia, can be invaluable when we think of what possible health concerns we might face in the future based on what was visited upon our ancestors. And believe it or not, it's the same as the port. Same with the port. Keeping records on who did what, where they did it, and for how long has proven invaluable for our environmental remediation efforts. There are different rules in the past, and sometimes no rules at all, concerning port and tenant operations. Knowing where certain industries were located within the port gives us foreknowledge of where possible environmental ailments might pop up in the future. Or as they did in the past, when we were building the mill plane extension in the late 1990s and the TCE plume was discovered. Our history played an enormous role in determining the source of the plume and from whom to seek compensation for its cleanup. And we're pleased to say that we're nearing the completion of that multi-year effort and have successfully cleaned more than 3.5 billion gallons of groundwater. That history also taught us a very valuable lesson concerning our environment. Much like the person who reads that a number of their aunts, uncles, and grandparents suffered from diabetes, and it might behoove them to cut back on their sweets, exercise more, and maybe monitor their blood sugar regularly, so has our port conducted regular environmental audits for these past 22 years to prevent any future environmental ailments from occurring. Now, producing a book about oneself might seem a bit egotistical. In the port's case, you might say self-promotional. Guilty. We are promoting ourselves with the publication of the Centennial History Book. But it's not blatant advertising. Think of it like a high school yearbook, and the school year it celebrates is a century long. The book celebrates what the port truly is, a collective of dedicated people assembled in this locale working for the perpetuation of this enterprise. It includes port commissioners, administration, maintenance, security, longshore, industrial attendants, shippers, both present and past. And the attempt to tell our story has happened before. Next slide, Katie. Thank you. The Clark County League of Women Voters penned what could be called a summation of the port in both 1975 and a decade later in 1985. The focus of these works was more on the characteristics of the port rather than the people who worked to sustain the port for those decades. Next slide, please. In between these two efforts was a treatment by the firm Words and Pictures Company Limited for a book entitled Trappers, Troubles, and Grit, The Story of the Port of Vancouver, which was submitted in celebration of the port's then 70th anniversary in 1982 and remains in cartoon form. While this book included more of the backstory of local maritime endeavors, its focus was a bit more narrow when it came to the problems the port faced then. It did, however, provide some amusing insight into the efforts by staff in keeping the port going when money was beyond tight, such as the search for free railroad ties around the county for use on the port's rail tracks, and the harvesting of much-needed timbers to shore up both Terminals 1 and 2, many from some very unlikely sources. But the lesson of doing what you had to do to make things work is prominent, and one in which we strive to embody every day here. To do the history of the port right, you need perspective, and it would be difficult for someone on the inside of the port to pen the history correctly because we are, as they say, in the belly of the beast. Luckily, with a centennial history book, we are able to rely on the talents of a professional writer and researcher who could offer an outside perspective, Ted Van Arsdell. Next slide, Katie. Thank you. Some or most of you might know of Ted, a World War II veteran, then a reporter for the Columbian, and through it all, a historian. Ted has written a number of books, stories, and manuscripts through the years on history, both local and national. And his book, Vancouver on the Columbia, still serves as a prime gateway book to our local history 25 years after its publication. Ted understood that the actions of the port impact the community industries that grow or don't grow around it. But he also understood that the port is in itself impacted by the community and those industries as well. It is a symbiotic relationship, and an important one to pay attention to. That is why the book begins long before the port's creation, to show what conditions were like as the port came into existence. And again, like a school yearbook, our centennial book, all ahead full, showcases that most important element of all, people. School clubs are replaced by port tenants, industries, and events, all put in motion by people. People who worked here, people who did business here, people who paid taxes and elected people to run this community endeavor, their port. It showcases a special time, in this case our first century. It also serves as an endpoint to that first century. It celebrates our efforts, our endeavors, our trials, our successes of this first century, and with much relief, it is done. The book is finished. And like that last day of school, we'll pass around this yearbook and celebrate the first century and learn from it. Now, on to the next one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matt.
Thank you, Matt.
Matt, do you have those books back in your archives, the other ones you mentioned?
I do.
Particularly the Trades, Troubles, and Grit?
I do.
All right. Thank you.
We are so fortunate to have Matt on our staff, and he is so zealous and so anxious to accumulate information about the port. He's just so special. Thank you, Matt.